Now, without me going into further detail, I thought I would invite our next guest on stage. It's a person that has driven more than 100 races. It's the most popular test and development Formula One driver, has raced for 15 years, predominantly in McLaren and Ferrari. Ladies and gentlemen, please put your hand together for Pedro de la Rosa. So, this is the second time we're meeting this year. First time was in Madrid. It was just before the Formula One race, the Formula One season started. At the time, Fernando Alonso was still injured. Yes? And so you made some predictions at the time about the season. So what are your predictions today?
Well, we've had a difficult start for the McLaren team, as we all know. But, it's Fernando always told us that it was going to be a slow start because he was changing team for the mid to long-term benefit. And we have to be patient. You know, the results are not there, but no one promised that the results would be. And actually, my predictions, I think, were not that far away. No, I think actually they were spot on. No, yes. Perfect.
So how do you see the battle between the Mercedes drivers unfolding?
Well, it is starting to become a bit what we don't want. This is like a tennis game, you know, between Nico Rosberg and Lewis Hamilton, Nico Rosberg, and we want a bit a closer fight. We want other teams to join into the fight, like Ferrari. We wish McLaren, but I don't think this is the season we have to look into that, into the results straight away. So we need closer fight, and that's what we need. But Mercedes are doing such a great job. You know, they have developed the car more than anyone else. And the last race yesterday in Canada, a straight fight between Rosberg and Hamilton, and the third driver finished 40 seconds behind. So just that gives you an idea of their dominance and how strong they are.
And in terms of McLaren, the partnership between McLaren and Honda has admittedly been a little bit slow off the mark.
Yes, it's going slow off the mark, but it's slowly getting better. We have to understand that nowadays a power unit, we don't talk about engine anymore. We talk about power unit. And a power unit has many elements. I mean, you have the traditional internal combustion engine, the engine we are used to it, but then you have the battery pack, you have two electric motors as well, plus the control electronics. So all these elements have to work together. It's a bit like your applications, you know? The software applications need to connect to each other, understand each other, talk the same language. Well, I think that Honda is on that process, and they need to talk. The power unit needs to be synchronized as well with the chassis, with the car that McLaren is producing. I think they are understanding itself a bit more, but still, it's not an overnight work, you know? It's we are talking about a big organization with 1,200 people, and I think it will take at least another 6 months.
Did you try the simulator?
Yes, actually I did one lap and then I crashed and someone, Gustavo, said, perfect, super, you know, and then I jumped and came here, actually. You know, whenever there's always a simulator, it's always I don't really like to jump into a simulator because there's always one guy that has been testing the whole afternoon there. You jump into the simulator and he beats you.
Yes. And actually, there were five guys that beat you this afternoon. So.
But you are none of them.
No, yeah? No. I will try momentarily. So there's a lot of similarities between Formula One team and a technology business. The way you go about your strategy, your flawless execution, razor sharp attention to details. Yeah. And a lot of these things. So how does it feel when you have all these buttons on the steering wheel, all these people talking to you, adrenaline popping up, and then it's green light and you have to race? How do you manage to consolidate and control all of this?
Well, I think it's a very natural feeling that we've been developing our whole careers. We've been racing in karting since we were kids. And it's just something natural, really, you know? There's a point when you close your visor, you know you're alone. You're representing 1,200 people back in the factory, but there's no one that's going to tell you what to do. So it is just a feeling of self-confidence that you can do it, and that, very importantly, we never make mistakes, because race drivers never make mistakes. No, it's the rest.
That's the biggest similarity you have with a software business. It's always the fault of someone else.
Exactly.
Thank you very much.
Exactly. Okay. Well, welcome. Thanks, SAP, again, Steve. Thanks for the belief, the trust, all of these years. We're going to start with a Formula One presentation, but before we go into my presentation, I want to show you a video, which is a perfect example of what you can do with very little, but a lot of imagination. Limited budget, but with a lot of imagination, creativity. Carlos Jean is a Spanish music producer that he went to Maranello, the headquarters of the Ferrari Formula One team. Yes, we also are going to talk a bit about Ferrari because I spent there 2 years, so I still have some ties with those friends. But this is a great video because this music producer went there with a tape, a sound recorder, and a video camera. And he just went department by department, just listening to the sounds of things, of a Formula One tire bouncing on the ground, or a hydraulic jack, a wheel gun, how the radio communications between drivers and engineers while we were testing in Fiorano, the sound of the Formula One engine. And he put everything together. He gave one laptop to myself, to Fernando Alonso, Felipe Massa, Marc Gené. And he said, look, guys, I am the director of the orchestra. And every time I point at you, yourself with your laptop will have to press the space key. So basically, we just act upon his request. And all in all, we put together this song that now the video, please. I think it's a really, really cool video that you will see.
Great job.
Yeah, great video. Apologies, Forza Ferrari. We are all McLaren fans here, aren't we? So continuing, and just before entering my presentation, I will let's just go through some bullet points of Formula One so that we are all aligned. You have to understand that a Formula One team is just a big organization. It's around 1,200 people, 600 from that work in the chassis, the car, and then the 600 on the engine manufacturer. Just for 20 Grand Prix, 20 weekends a year for two cars, around 35,000 kilometers of races and testing. TV audiences go to 2,093 million annualized figures. This is the third highest behind the Summer Olympics and the NFL, but in front of the World Cup. So I think this is a very, very important fact. Rate of development, what does this mean? This is the speed at what we need to develop the car each race so that we keep winning. And this is normally quantified in 15 hundredths of a second per race. 20 races a year, it's about 3 seconds. At 300 kph, 3 seconds means you travel 250 meters more or less during a lap. And if at the end of the season you haven't found those 15.5 or 15 hundredths, you will lose 250 meters every lap. So in a few laps, you have lost one whole lap to the leader. We are only 25 days a year all under the same roof. Basically, I mean, what I say, this means drivers, mechanics, engineers, management, etc. We are very, very few days we work face to face. And the season budgets go from a spread from 100 to 350 million euro. This is more or less what a modern Formula One team needs to win, 350 million. And this income is divided 60% on TV rights that are provided by Formula One management and the 40% sponsorship agreements. If we have a look at this slide, you will realize why is always the same two, three teams that dominate Formula One that win? Well, it's quite simple. They get most of the budget from the TV rights. The payouts go to themselves. They have very good sponsorship agreements. And then it's difficult to ask a Sauber, a Marussia, a Lotus to win a race when they have such a smaller budget. Okay, let's start now on the presentation. Now we are all aligned, we know what we are talking about, and I'm going to base my presentation around several values, several characteristics. Reliability is one, simplicity, creativity, competitiveness, innovation, and commitment. And we are going to start with reliability. The harder you work, the luckier you get. This was said by a great golf player called Gary Player. I'm sure it's the same in any of your businesses. You know, if suddenly we get lucky, the more hours we spend doing things. And how do we achieve reliability in our sport, in Formula One? Very simple, by working with a good plan, a good strategy behind. Drivers, we need to be fit, and the best way of being fit is running around the track, for example, on a Thursday before a Grand Prix, to adapt to the humidity levels, to the temperature, to the check the bumps, the curbs, everything. That photograph I put there is me, myself, running with Alonso around Singapore track. It was 8 p.m. at night, and Fernando came to me and said, Pedro, let's go running. Let's go running because it's 8 p.m., it's very late, but the race was at 8 p.m. on Sunday. And he said, the earlier we adapt to the conditions of humidity, the better. And we did so. And then when we arrived after two laps, completely sweaty to the hotel, I remember going in, and the youngsters, the new generation drivers, the ones that say they are better than us, but they are not, they were just coming out of the gym, completely sweated, you know, and they're really tired. And Alonso looked at me, I looked at Alonso, and we just laughed because they were coming out of a gym full of air conditioning. Well, they didn't get the point. The point really is to adapt to the humidity level and the heat you're going to face at the race, 8 p.m. on that day in Singapore. Well, anyway, thanks God. These are the reasons why I'm still here, you know, because I'm 44 years old, but you feel that you know a bit more about the tricks that other drivers haven't yet found. I also put this other beautiful picture, which is a Formula One car. All the components of a Formula One car, 80,000 components, I repeat, 80,000 components, all hanging on strings, and it gives you a very good idea of how complex a Formula One car can be. If we build this car 99.9% perfectly well, we assemble this car to 99.9, there will be 80 pieces, components that are not properly assembled. So this will mean that we won't get the reliability that we're looking for. This will mean that we won't complete 305 kilometers. That's what a Grand Prix has to last. This picture of some mechanics cleaning the garage floor, it's very important, you know? Cleanliness, tidiness in this business, it's critical. McLaren, for example, are well known for being the number ones in tidiness, cleanness, and thanks a lot is because they have Ron Dennis, the team principal, that is absolutely always looking into the small details. Why? Because a clean car will always be faster than a slow car, but more importantly, it will be more reliable. It's not because then the sponsors shine more or less. No, it has a reason behind. And if you look at the McLaren mechanics through the past 20 years, they've always had white shirts or t-shirts on. And it's not because someone likes white. It's because the white is the color of the doctors. And believe me, it's not the best color to when you have to work on a car, but it's the cleanest color. And any small black mark, you need to get changed. That's small details of what is required in Formula One. I'm going to show you two videos, very, very fast videos of fantastic teamwork. It's when you enter the pits and change the tires. And when you enter the pits, you rely on the team to do a fantastic job, to change the four tires very fast, but also in a very safe manner. And the first one is when everything goes perfectly well. And this video is of Mark Webber in the Malaysian Grand Prix. He did the fastest ever recorded pit stop of 2.05 seconds, four tires change. Pay attention to this video because it's just seen and not seen. Yes. Not bad, eh? Not bad. It's nearly like when we go to the fuel station. Well, in Spain at least, we're very quick. This was the fastest ever recorded. Some teams say, wow, we've gone under 2 seconds. Yes, but no one has ever recorded that. They do it when they test in the factory. And now I'm going to put this other video of same process. This was when refueling was still back on. And when everything, absolutely everything, goes wrong. Let's see it.
Okay,
What a miracle that nothing else happened. But that was Felipe Massa in Singapore. He lost that race. He was leading. Eventually, he lost the world championship. Why? Is it it was Felipe's fault? Was it the team? What do you think? Could be both. It was the team's fault. The team told him to start and leave. And he pulled the refueling rig and everything. And you know what? He lost the world championship because of that. 2008, he lost the world championship because of that. But Felipe never ever said anything against the team or blamed the team. He always said, we win and we lose together, which is a phrase we've heard many times. But when it happens to you, then you need to be brave to say it. That's why my respect over Felipe Massa has increased over the past few years, thanks to these situations. Simplicity. How important it is to keep it in this world of data and complications and complexities to keep it simple. I love this phrase, help me to do it alone. It's Maria Montessori, it's an Italian professor, educator that died, what she said always is that to teach a child something that he will always, always remember, you have to teach him in a way that he will have to experiment. It's not good enough to tell you have to memorize this because he will eventually lose or forget it. And this is how I feel. In a way, race drivers, we are kids. We start very early, from 5, 6 years old. We start testing, go with our parents, and then eventually we go alone. And we are always training, firstly with a trainer, but then the Formula One world gets so complicated with so many traveling and so many events, as you will see later on in the presentation, that there's a point that you find yourself training always alone. That's why it's important to have learned the lesson. These exercises is a normal couple, every 2 days I do more or less this table of exercises, and you will say, yeah, I can do that. Yeah, not bad. Yeah, I do it very often at home even. And you're right. It's not difficult at all. It's very simple, actually. But you have to do it. And you have to do it with attitude. And you have to do it when you're tired and when you travel and when you don't want to do it. That's the key of the training of any Formula One driver. And I want to show you this picture because that is a bit more specific and more difficult. It's the neck training that a Formula One driver needs to do. You need to train your neck because on the corners, that on deceleration, you go over 4 and 5 Gs, 4 or 5 times your body weight. And that's why we have these special machines. I have one at home 2 times a week. I do 20-minute sessions. It's not a lot, but regularly. And actually, this machine that I have at home, I bought it from another driver. It's Juan Pablo Montoya, Colombian driver. Don't know if you position him. He's a fantastic driver, still winning in India in Indy 500. And this guy left Formula One, left McLaren. So I said, Juan Pablo, I want to buy your machine, your neck machine. And I bought it for a good price, actually. I made a good deal. And he sold it to me. When this machine arrived, it still had the plastic cover on. He had never used it ever. So, you know, what I mean is that competitive drivers, there's the very professional ones that do their discipline, their routine, their test, you know, the physical training, and there's the other ones that still win, but they don't know why. They just are very natural. It's two concepts. You know, I need to do very disciplined training, and otherwise, I don't think that anyone can get to 44 years old in a good state of mind and physical without a very disciplined training. But I wanted just to show you that you can find both sides. And what is what we face? What we face during a race, Formula One, is around nearly 2 hours, 1 hour and 45 minutes on average, of a heart rate of around 165, 170 during the whole race. This is my heart in the Hungarian Grand Prix 2010. And you can see that it's not a flat line. The heart is never flat because on the straights, you relax, you take a breath, the heartbeat drops, and then in the corners where you have to hold your body for 4 or 5 times the body weight, it peaks again. So that's the reason why you have this oscillation. Not difficult, you know, with a specific training, but you need to train. You need to also drink a lot of water. That's the biggest problem of a Formula One driver is dehydration. It's not what your heart does, it's mainly dehydration levels. So you need to be drinking 1.5 liters per race. We have a little tube, a drinks button, and you have to keep on doing it. Otherwise, you can end up with some blanks. And we were talking before with Steve of flawless execution. No, I like this phrase because it just, when I see this video, I say to myself, this is a flawless execution of simplicity as well. Because let's see the video and I will talk on top of it. Because look at Fernando Alonso, this is a Spanish Grand Prix 2011. On the left of the image, the red car, how he goes behind the Red Bull, one side to the other, one, bum, bum, goes into the squeeze onto the grass and overtakes. How simple does it look? It looks like a radio control car, you know? I mean, it just looks very simple. But then we look at it from the onboard camera and things start to become a bit more complicated, you see? Because the car start become a lot more violent and the spaces that look very big on TV then start to look a lot more narrow. And then if we look into it with a bit more detail, we start getting scared because you see how he drops the clutch, how he shifts it to second, how he tries to get the toe of the Red Bull, how he overtakes the first Red Bull to 74, and it's quicker than what we were thinking about, and then the second one at 290. So, you know, it looks simple, but it's actually, it has a lot of talent involved. And this is the beauty of the greats, that they make simple what is actually quite complicated for any of us. And I open up just brackets just to talk about logistics, because that's where SAP as well is extreme help to the McLaren team and to, in fact, to any organization. A Formula One team is a big or a logistic organization. And I want to give you some details of what Formula One operation involves. 80 team personnel travel to each of the 20 Grand Prix, but then you have to think about the next 20 that are dedicated to the engine, to the power unit. Total of 100. This includes the cookers, the waitress, the physiotherapist, the drivers, everyone. And during the Formula One World Championship, a team will transport around 40 tons, 40,000 kilos in containers. 1 kilo of air freight costs a Formula One team $300. You multiply 340,000 kilos, $12 million already goes on air freight. Team personnel during the European Grand Prix will fly in charter flights. This has a reason, it's efficiency. We go to Spa Grand Prix, we race on a Sunday, the mechanics pack up everything, put everything in boxes, trucks, and then they arrive midnight to Brussels Airport. There's no flights, but the team charters one so that everyone can travel at night to their base, and next morning at 9 o'clock start working on the cars again. You gain one day of work. The small teams don't have this possibility because their structures are smaller. They don't have the money either. So they lose 20 Grand Prix, multiply half a day, one day of lost. It's nearly 1 month that the big teams work harder to find that 0.15 hundreds we were talking about before. The hospitality units, they are a bit different. I mean, I have put these two pictures just to show you two different styles. The McLaren Honda style, which is basically all in one, which means same space, but higher levels, more floors, where guests, sponsors, drivers, teams, team members will cohabitate during a Grand Prix weekend. And then on top, the Ferrari hospitality unit, two different hospitality units, one for the team, one for the guests, sponsors, and press. Different concepts, but bottom line is they do. You spend a lot of hours during a weekend on those buildings. The McLaren Honda one, when they built it, it was so beautiful and so big and that we used to call it a Terminal 5 Heathrow Airport Terminal, which was not really, really very much like there, but it works very well. Then when we go to the flyaways, to the Grand Prix that are outside Europe, the situation changes a bit because basically 2 months prior or to the Grand Prix, the teams will ship the fuels and lubricants for safety reasons, so 2 months before the race starts. 9 days before Australia, which is the first Grand Prix of the season, the teams will send everything to Australia. We will finish testing in Barcelona end of February, and the first week of March we will have the first race, and all the air freight will be loaded into the FOM jumbos, which is the picture on the top. 16 to 18,000 liters of fuel are used per season, and 1,600 of tires. Tires are sent by Pirelli, taken care of. At the end of the picture, at the end of all this organization, of all this year of traveling, logistics, races, testing, the question is, how many days does the team personnel stay away from home? Well, the answer is 200 days. And then the next question is, how many days does a test driver like myself stay away from home? And this slide is the answer. It's the answer. This is my annual schedule for the last couple of years with Ferrari, actually. And you can see I spent 75 days of Grand Prix outside home. I spent 75 days of test days, simulator test days, and 136 days I am traveling to Australia, Malaysia, China, whatever, following the championship. And on top of that, I have some PR events. Total of 293 days outside home. This has been the past 15 years of my life. So that's the reason why this year I put a bit the handbrake, because the family, you always have to balance a bit, and it was getting a bit too much. Being a test driver, you have the worst of the both lives. You know, you have to be out on the Grand Prix hoping that something happens and you can jump into the car, but then during the week you have to be testing in the simulator on the racetrack, so you need to spend a lot of days outside home. We move to creativity, and please can you start the video. This video is would like to explain what the DRS is, because we talk about DRS, but really no one, I don't find many people that really know what DRS is. And DRS is drag reduction system. It's a system to improve the speed in the straights so that the drivers have more chances of overtaking. And in these figures, in these drawings, we can see, first of all, the position of a Formula One driver, which is extreme. The second is that we only have two pedals, throttle on the right, the brake on the left. And you can see on this detailed picture that we have the DRS activating button, which is placed near our feet. So how it would work? We go on the straight, and you're flat out, and you activate the DRS. The flap opens up, you achieve 20 kph extra top speed. But then you get to the corner, you have to brake, so immediately you have to back off from the button of DRS and brake immediately. You can do it as well with your hands. Actually, this is much what I've always done, and it's much more simple because I have a better feeling on the finger. So on the straights, when you want to overtake someone, when you have the possibility to use it, you press the button, the air that normally circulates like this circulates in a much easier way with less drag. You go much faster on the straights, you can overtake. Fantastic system, very simple, but very creative, because actually this made in 2010 from 547 overtaking maneuvers in the whole year, it went to 1,486, so nearly three times in 1 year thanks to the DRS. I find it fantastic invention. And now we move on into innovation, because if creativity is thinking up all of these new things, innovation is actually doing these new things. And here are two pictures of what is a simulator. Formula One simulator is, what is a simulator? It's difficult to explain. It's like a huge PlayStation, you know, with a 3D screen, a motion platform that moves around in a very similar manner as a Formula One would move. So it's quite aggressive, and this is where we spend most of our time now, in these rooms. The top picture is the Ferrari concept, which is a hydraulic simulator activated by these legs, and then the bottom picture is the is the one of McLaren, which is electromagnetic platform, which is very, I think it's a bit better, more efficient, more aggressive on the movement. But simulator is the easiest way of developing a car, but not the easiest, the cheapest. Because every part that we try in the simulator, if it shows promise, it goes into production. If it doesn't show promise in the simulator, we move on into another project. So it's very cheap. It just saves you a lot of time. If you're looking for different results, you must do different things. This is a wind tunnel. This is the most important tool Formula One team has to develop its car, to find that 1/1500th of a second per race that we were talking before. And this is this technology comes from the aerospace industry. Engineers through the years had always put the car straight in the wind tunnel, like an airplane, because it comes from the aerospace business. But the most innovative, creative of the aerodynamicists start questioning, why should we put a car if in the corners the car is not straight? And to generate downforce, a force that pushes the car into the ground, you need actually dynamics to work in the corner with yaw and with steering angle. And that's when they started saying, look, we need to improve this. We have to change things. We must do things differently. And this is when they started rotating the car in the wind tunnel. It's not by accident that the best teams in the past decades, McLaren and Red Bull, have the best aerodynamicists that started this new concept. And we're going to change a bit into innovation, but innovation around safety. Because I'm going to show you the two most important changes that have happened in Formula One and have increased the safety is the introduction of, obviously, of the carbon, the carbon into our industry, into our business, but especially the production of carbon shell of a seat, of one piece, that in case you have an accident, they can extract you without pulling you, just with taking the seat out, the one piece carbon shell. And then the second one is the one in the bottom, is the introduction of the hands, the head and neck support system. And this is a very, very important introduction, because it's like a carbon fiber boomerang around your neck. And this initially was terrible for us, because it just feels very awkward to drive a Formula One car with like a carbon boomerang around your neck. It makes you feel very unsafe. And it took us like more than 1 year to get comfortable and accepting this change. But it worked. It worked so well. And I think that this video is a perfect example of where we are, how much safety has improved. 2 weeks ago, Max Verstappen had this accident and he walked away. Let's watch this video. Well, he says, I'm okay. I mean, he's not perfectly okay, but he's nearly fine, you know? But I think that if we hadn't innovated or changed many things, Max Verstappen would obviously have been injured. And we move now just to competitiveness and data, our world. Because we are competitive animals, we like to compete, but there is so much data nowadays, telemetry data, the amount of sensors that a Formula One car has, Steve was saying around 7,000, that keep sending this information to the garages, to our engineers. And where SAP is helping us massively is in processing all this data, analyzing and presenting to the driver as well what we really need, because we don't need 7,000 parameters. I mean, this is too much for us. We need basically what can make us go faster. And what can help us to go faster? Is mainly from all these lines, just this one, which is speed. Speed is the one that gives you the lap time. And this is the one we are obsessed about. this telemetry data, for example, is of myself against my teammate in Barcelona racetrack. I am in red, my teammate is in blue. And you can see that, for example, here it's end of straight in Barcelona, braking into turn one, you decrease the speed, you accelerate, you decrease the speed, you accelerate again. And you can see that at some points, the lines open up. This means that the red driver, which is me, is going faster than the blue one because it's under. So basically there I'm faster. And that's why I put it here. It's because I'm faster than my teammate, because if not, I wouldn't put anything. But this is interesting because your teammate is your first enemy. You know, you have to work with him but against him, because if you beat him, you will continue in Formula One. He will earn you your own living. But if he beats you, you're out. This business is very simple. So it's important that we focus on the right things, on the simple things, straight away during a qualifying session when we come into the garage and we need, give me the speed, Trace. This is a driver analysis telemetry data sheet of paper. This is what we would do when the drivers are sitting in the car and they are looking. This is what they're looking. And we're getting to the end, and I want to put this video because it is the best Grand Prix of the season. For me, it's the Singapore Grand Prix. It's a night race, fully spectacular. This video summarizes very much the competitiveness between not only drivers and race engineers, but also mechanics, spectators, engineers, team principals, radio communications between race engineers, drivers, that we will comment later on. Watch this video, and if you have time, take your wife to Singapore for this Grand Prix. I recommend it to you. Remember, I mean, the communication between Massa and his race engineer. His race engineer said, destroy Hamilton's race as much as you can. Come on, boy. No, I mean, it's just interesting because people were scandalized, a bit surprised about this. It's normal. This is sport, you know. Sometimes you need your race engineer to push you into a bit of aggression. And finally, commitment. I would like to say, you know, Machiavelli used to say, the end justifies the means. Well, I think that it's impossible to have this phase of full happiness in the podium if you have done the things like Machiavelli said. It's impossible. I think that you can only have that phase of full happiness if you have shown full commitment to yourself, to your fans, spectators, but especially to your own team. And I want to read this phrase of Michael Jordan because it's truly inspirational. It says, I have missed more than 9,000 shots in my career. I have lost almost 300 games. 26 times I've been trusted to take the game winning shot and missed. I failed over and over and over again in my life, and that is why I succeed. So, what a great phrase. Sometimes I think we just need to repeat it to ourselves just to gain that extra self-confidence. And finally, you know, we've been talking about Formula One, other drivers, Massa, Hamilton, blah, blah, blah. And I would like to talk about myself, you know. So. I came here to talk about myself, so I think we have a couple of hours now still. And this is the last video, and this is the most emotional video of my career because it's the video where I overtake Michael Schumacher in my best ever position in Formula One, second position in Hungary 2006. Michael Schumacher is a long-time hero for all of us, for myself especially, and eventually one day I managed to overtake him. Just have a look and pay attention to the shot at the end of my helmet. Please, let's have a look. SAP, thank you very much. I think we come a long time together. Thanks for the trust. Thank you very much. Thanks.